X-ray attenuation measurements of a breast tissue famine. And my name is Matthew Briggs. My principal investigator is Mihai Gherase. He's on site somewhere. He didn't turn up to this. I have no idea why. Basically, we'll be working through looking at breast tissue, which I think is a major issue. We're all keen to provide people with affordable treatment, try and detect it, breast cancer. And that's our main motivator, actually. If you look at a conventional diagnostic X-ray, the fine cancers, contrast is key. It's either that we go hunting for morphology over time, you know. And we want to image tumorous materials, but we know that the materials in the breast, for instance, fibrous materials, have a very similar attenuation for X-rays. And we want to develop a contrast, otherwise you're going to end up not being able to examine breasts properly. So the beginning of the work is that we need to measure with accuracy, because the difference between the contrast is very small. The linear attenuation in proposed breast tissue phantoms, and the hope to move on to actual breast tissue, which is expensive and hard to get unless you've got a cadaver out there. Don't have access to it. So the goal is to use X-ray scattering, this is the long-term goal, to provide that enhanced contrast and to develop the imaging of breast tissues for tumors. Of course, the actual goal is to make a really good projection, differential phase contrast projection of breast cancers and tumors. And with this sort of thing, you can just use low brings, lab-based X-ray sources to do this kind of imaging in the lab, and probably out in the field with patients as well. It doesn't require a lot of energy, and it's of interest for a wide range of applications. Here's somebody did a very good image of a hornet, a beautiful hornet here. Probably you don't care too much for hornets, but there's our differential phase contrast projection. There's a tomographic slice, and there is a 3D developed representation of our hornet, and fully 3D, which is pretty exciting. And you can use this kind of imaging once you have the contrast necessary to find the tumors, to find the location and treat. You can treat effectively with that knowledge. And the potential for imaging structures within the body is an exciting topic. We already know that scattered images have a potential to identify structures like tumors in biological structures. But here, we have a bit of beef ox tail for the hungry among us. I'm not eating this today. But we can identify, of course, just with a plain image, fat and muscle tissue. When we go here, we're actually doing a proper beam scatter image of the oxtail. This was using something like 15 beams, and that'd be from a linear accelerator, so it's not suitable for diagnosing patients. It's too much power. But yeah, you don't want to fright your patients, you want to treat them, diagnose them. But you can see the contrast comes up really well. And this is a conventional X-ray, because you can't see that differential easily. So this is really something to aim for. This is the challenge, overcoming poor contrast. We overcome that, we're golden, we can find all the breast cancer that we like. So that's where we're at. And to that, you may recognize this from previous speakers. We need to understand X-ray attenuation law. So we have a number of photons being attenuated by a constant mu. T, confusingly enough, is the thickness of the sample. So this attenuation for photon energies is below the per production threshold, which is about 1 MeV, and you includes the free favorite X-ray photon interactions. So you have your photoelectric absorption, your elastic scattering, and your inelastic scattering. And the mu depends on elemental composition and mass density. Now, we noticed some morphology differences between fibrous tissue and cancerous tissue. And it's the take-up of unusual materials is small, so you're more talking about density. Obviously, breast cancer is more dense. It's living on itself and reproducing with wild abandon, so it doesn't care to produce those beautiful structures that you find in the body. So it creates a linear attenuation coefficient that's slightly different, and we can account for that. Mark with the equation, you get the method for calculating the linear attenuation coefficient. 1 over the thickness of the sample, multiplied by the logarithm of the spectrometric quantity in air versus in your slice of material. Right. So to get our spectrometric quantity, we'll do a peak area analysis of the feature of interest. In this case, it's L-shell of XRF from a tungsten source. And you'll do a count through air and a count through slice. And you also take into account the average of the Briggs strata. It's not very useful to do it in one KeV interval. My samples, we start with our comparison, which is aluminium, it's easy enough, and a resin plus salt. That's my phantom. It's basically resin and salt. You alter the amount of salt, you can affect the attenuation. And you produce a phantom that can replicate the X-ray attenuation of cancerous materials or fibrous materials within a breast. And by the way, this, the current being fed into the device producing the X-rays is 0.001 milliamp. So we're not dealing with a log hour to do this, which makes it better for patients. We don't want to set them to death doing our work. But we're not to the patients yet. We're just doing our little experiment on our X-ray platform. We have our polycapillary X-ray lens. We have our sample on a mount here. We have a rotating aluminium support platform that we alter the angle for because the interaction is angle dependent. Our magnetic support with our digital galvanometer. That's the right pronunciation. I'm doing very well. Basically, it's like a protractor, digital protractor, right? It allows you to adjust the angle. And a multi-channel analyzer at the back takes care of the hard yards with gathering data. And you can see on this side, we have our sample. It's like on almost like a microscope slide mount, except nothing behind it. So the X-rays will just pass through. We use our 4 millimeter distance here as our foci, because that's just the property of this X-ray lens setup. And we try to gather all the information for an aluminium collimator into our X-ray detector. And our multi-channel analyzer processes the data. Sitting on oxymethylene block, and we try to reduce the amount of scattering of X-rays because that affects the results. Okay. Well, that's the experimental setup. That's fun. It's basically what I just described. Here's our phantom preparation. It's 98% resin, 1.8% salt for fibrous. And the goal is to increase that phantom mu value, and we use aluminium for confirmation. This is our result. It agrees well with published results for linear attenuation for fibrous material. Now, we haven't got to doing our tumorous phantom. I've got it sitting around the lab. Very similar. Just a similar amount of salt, but it's different. But we are getting good fit with the resin consultant in the study with. with fibrous breast figures. It's within error at higher energy. If I look at aluminium for our confirmation, you also see it fits well. Maybe not so well at low energy, that's probably because of introduced scattering at low energy, but we don't work at low energy, we fit for higher energy. So it's working very well. And here's some future work ideas. We're going to do future characterization, we're going to do forward scattered contrast testing for the phantoms, and then if we can get some breast cancer samples, we'll go with that. Thank you. Any questions? Yo.
So in terms of this technique versus other techniques of detecting breast cancer, what are the benefits of this specific technique? Because people hear x-rays and they're kind of like oh no, that's dangerous. So
then you try to put them for an MRI and see how you go. Especially older women. I remember my grandmother complaining incessantly about the noise, about the restrictiveness of the MRI. The ability to do x-ray, which is cheaper and more effective, it's not dangerous, it's low energy. It's incredibly low energy. We are managing the safety of these x-rays for potential use in patients. So I think MRI studies in particular are negative, but produce negative outcomes because people won't do them or won't stay still for them. CT, it doesn't provide good contrast either. X-ray is better. And if we can develop that contrast, we've got a superior technique. Tomography requires just images in lots of different directions. This forward scattering x-ray technique will provide images that will highlight the cancer, whereas tomography is not set up for that with CT. That makes sense?
Is it still sourced by x-rays?
Well, everything's sourced by x-rays, yes, but this technique will actually provide the imaging required to get to the cancer. Yeah?
So you said that your results were similar to published data. Does that mean there's already something out there similar to the process you're utilizing?
Well, people have talked about forward scatter for providing contrast. They've used other materials to show that. But I'm trying to do a breast cancer, which has a smaller contrast difference, and that's a powerful use for this technique that needs to be developed further. Go.
Very quickly.
Okay, yeah, you mentioned about you're doing specifically on breast cancer. Do you know if this technique works on other types of cancers or other types of diseases that can be motivated?
I believe other cancers are a definite possibility. I think breast cancers are very important use because of the need to. And the simplicity of studying breasts in that way. If you try to look at other cancers in the body, you have much bigger mass that go through, and you have other things in the array like bone. It's always been a better use of X-ray and other techniques to look at breast cancer. And it's a common